Hey, me fella. Look here.
Stand by.
One for C-Lab, two for Tor Eagle, three for Mobile Green to round out the trio in this episode. Everybody dies.
Broadcasting live from inside your local mall, this is The Blah. In this episode, everybody dies. I'm your host, Kevin, along with my super-powered mall companions. Head in a jar, he go.
Snoochie boochies.
There you go.
Snoochie boochie woochie boo.
Ooh, nice mashup there, C-Lab, Slab, and Slab. Of course, everybody, let's say hello to Slab.
Yo.
Cue the canned clapping.
Maybe my name could be Slab Bob for this or something.
Ooh, there you go, Slab Bob. Welcome to the show, folks. This week, we're talking about the exciting 1995 cult classic, Mallrats, from our good friend Kevin Smith, starring a host of wonderful people, many when they were starting out. Joey Lauren Adams, Ben Affleck, friend of the show, Jason Lee, Jeremy London, Shannon Doherty, and of course, Yondu himself, Michael Rooker. Let's start the show. High level.
Did you mention Sven Ole Thorsen?
Oh, God, I have to. I'm so sorry, dude. That's a death. It's a death not to mention Sven, dude, because we've talked about him in the past. Sven Ole Thorsen. Ladies and gentlemen, let's start the show.
Who is Sven Ole Thorsen again? I remember talking about him, but...
Is the security guard.
Oh, yeah.
The big security guard dude with the...
Schwarzenegger's buddy.
And what else was he in?
Like, everything Schwarzenegger's done.
Oh, okay.
Right? I think we figured that out when he did Running Man.
I'll take a death for that.
Yeah.
Yes, you will.
Definitely in Conan the Destroyer.
Nice. High level. This movie was super relevant when I was 15. I had a couple of chuckles, and I think my tastes have broadened, and I didn't really give a shit. I think the world has moved on. I like Kevin Smith. I think he seems like a fucking solid dude, but... I don't know. Looking back on his stuff, I think it's a bit one note at this stage. And I don't know. I like the dude. He's funny. He does like funny live stuff. But I think 15-year-old me dug this, and not 15-year-old me was just kind of like, eh. So curious to see if you guys felt similarly.
Wow. I really can't believe that you're this salty about this movie. I can't wait to hear more.
I'm not salty. I just kind of was like,
eh, a little
fucking,
bit.
I don't know. I will also, just if you don't mind the minor cul-de-sac, like I found a copy that fell off the back of a truck and watched it and was like,
we'll allow it.
Really confused about like the opening. It was like a 15-minute long opening of like a governor getting fucking shot by TS on the roof of a building. Did you guys watch that particular version? Because it turns out it's like a different version.
This must be the extended version. I think the like a longer version came out with the Blu-ray release or something.
Oh, okay.
And it's apparently really bad.
That's probably why I sounds feel this terrible. Way.
Probably coloring your actual...
Yeah, okay. That makes way more sense because I remembered it not being as fucking ridiculous. But
I went to rent this on Vudu, and I had the choice between the extended cut and the regular. I almost clicked the extended cut, and then I was like, you know what? Let me just be a purist for this.
That's what I for the show. I didn't even know there was an extended cut. I would have preferred the regular.
I didn't either.
Yeah. The original cut starts off with, you know, sort of a montage going on while Brody tells a story about his I don't remember, his cousin, I guess, or his uncle getting a cat stuck up his ass.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah, that wasn't the one I watched. Okay, that makes more sense.
Okay. Well, here we've kind of, look, we've already solved one of the problems.
You see?
You see?
You see? Do you see? The doctor and me? Did you see?
Oh, cancer boy.
Sorry. That's okay. My marrow's just low.
Dude, can we just call the sack about the... can we call the sack about
song that he plays? What is he, like...
Oh, my God.
I love it.
I think perhaps a small cul-de-sac is due... talking about the Kids in the Hall movie. I'm a little bit confused because we just got a message from Pyburn. What up? About today, about a Kids in the Hall series returning. I'm slightly confused. I'm excited about the prospect of a Kids in the Hall series returning, and I was definitely stoked about seeing the trailer for the new Kids in the Hall movie that had Brain Candy alum Don as one of the characters. As soon as I saw that, I was like, I'm in.
Totally. Yeah, I believe that is a trailer for the new Kids in the Hall series.
Oh, I thought it was a movie, too.
Oh, I thought it was a movie, dude. I was like, they're going to make a sequel to Brain Candy? Brilliant.
No. Gotcha. There's other stuff in there.
I would gander, lads, that this series is going to be, like, just next-level Kids in the Hall. You know what I mean? Like, if you kind of take, like, the great skill of the original show and then take, like, the kind of elevated level they got to with Brain Candy and then add, like, 20 years, you know? I think this is going to be really good.
I want to do the, like, coming to America treatment where I'm just going to, like, give them a huge benefit of the doubt and try and enjoy the fuck out of it, you know?
Well, I mean, look, Chad, I appreciate that sentiment, and I appreciate your cautiousness, Ben, but I'm optimistic because it is a series. I was optimistic when I thought it was a movie, but it's not like, okay, we're making, well, I mean, I guess if it was a movie, it would have been like we're making a sequel 20 years later. But the fact that it's a series means that they're really like all in on something, you know, cool. So I don't know.
I suppose I should note here that I just started recording, so...
That's all right, I've got it.
So there's that. Sorry! I think the world needs the Kids in the Hall, and I hope they're coming hard. That's all I can say.
There, I like that a lot. I'm going to give you a death for that lack of recording.
Oh, yes, please, please. I don't get enough deaths. Definitely need to document them when they happen.
For posterity. It's a risky dingo, man. It's a risky maneuver.
For posterity.
It is.
Doing the series 20 years later. But
I don't think they would do it unless they thought they had something.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to think that's the case. They're funny dudes, man. I don't know. I part of me wants to go back and watch everything again, and part of me doesn't want to, like, oversaturate myself, you know? I think one of the benefits of old school TV before streaming is, like, you kind of couldn't binge watch like an entire season of Seinfeld. You had to just watch whatever came up.
Yeah.
And I think that was part of what cemented some of these shows in the kind of legendary status that they have, is like you couldn't overdo it. You know, this is like pre-DVD even.
I don't know, man. I watched the Kids in the Hall religiously.
Yeah, me too. But like it was difficult to binge it, I think. You know, that's what I think caused it to be able to, like, cause shows like it to be able to sink into our psyches so much. Because, like, nowadays, everything just drops, like, a whole season drops, you watch it, and it's like, okay, done, and you never watch it again, and then the next show comes along, and you've already forgotten about the previous one, you know? Like, I think there's definitely something there.
No, I think there is something there as well, and I'd like to add that I think your point about oversaturation is key. Because you're kind of just like devouring a whole steak at once, you know, with like, on the one hand, it's great because you can watch it all and you can really kind of absorb yourself in the story when you're binging an entire season of something.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there's an oversaturation. Whereas before, when we had to wait 7 days, you were always kind of wanting more. You know what I mean? So there's something to be said for that.
Or even if it was in syndication, like a Seinfeld, and there was an episode every day, you had to, you know, you watch 30 minutes, and it's like a total grab bag of what episode it was, too, you know, unless you watched it on the actual episode night or whatever. So,
right. But if you were doing, like, even in the days of, like, syndication, like, if you were watching, you know, you'd flip on, like, you know, whatever it was, TNT or whatever, had, like, you know, a back-to-back Simpsons and Seinfeld, you know what I mean? Or
yeah, Fox or whatever.
Like, you'd get, like, yeah, or you'd get, like, a twofer of Seinfeld at a certain, you know, like, 6 o'clock or whatever. And it was, like, it was still just two episodes,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
Exactly.
You still didn't really have the access unless you bought the DVDs, like me.
But I feel like if I sat down and watched an entire season of Kids in the Hall, by the end of the season, a couple hours later, I'd just be like, all right, I'm kind of over this particular flavor of humor right now, just because it's just back to back to back to back. Nothing against the show.
I can
just
see that. You know, No. I think it's a matter of circumstance, brother.
Yeah. I remember, well, it was on HBO, so I used to watch it.
Was it?
Like, yeah, it started on it. I think it started its US release on HBO.
Yeah.
And, you know, so like anytime I would be like searching through the channels and I happened to like, they happened to be playing an episode of Kids in the Hall, I would just stop and watch it.
Yeah, totally.
So like I saw it quite a bit. That's me. But, yeah, you know. There's something to be said for that. Like, you just don't get that, like, radio effect anymore, like that spirit of the radio effect where it's, like, you know, serendipity or, you know, feeling like you just, like, want a scratchy or something because some song that you really love or were thinking about just happens to, like, pop on, you know?
No, totally.
You didn't pick it for yourself. It just was there, you know, that feeling of just finding it there. Like, definitely do not get that anymore.
Yeah.
Did you just say want a scratchy?
Yes.
Which I love.
One A scratchy.
Wow. Nice.
Not that I do scratchy.
When you said that, I was transported into a Cumbie's and was like super into it.
Dude, same here, man. I was just
one $5 ticket.
Dude, and that guy was there, front and center. And I was in a Cumbie's just right now. As soon as you said that, immediate transportation to Cumbie's.
Give me do number 3 and 4 number 5. Give me 3 $10 ticket.
were you guys aware of the Nantucket Cumbie's bump?
Cumbie's bump?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Yes. Yeah.
I don't know. What is that? Cumbie's bump? Is that what you said?
Yeah, the old Cumbie's. You used to park your cars along the side of the building, and the building was an old, shitty, ramshackle, fucking shingled building.
Oh, God, yeah. It was terrible.
And the high school kids, I don't think I ever participated. I might have. You'd go and you'd run from across the parking lot and slam your body into the side of the building, and if you did that, you'd knock all the cigarettes off the inside for the...
No, I didn't know.
Yeah.
It was a thing. It was a thing in high school. You'd go and do a Cumbie's bump, and I just, yeah. Ben, you transported me back to my youth, just like this movie did.
That sounds like a high school hijinks.
Yeah.
In an attempt to make a jankety segue here, it's very Clerks like.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very Jay and Silent
kind
Bob
of behavior.
They totally do that.
It is very Jay and Silent Bob.
Yeah. Oh, that's so totally Jay right there.
Yeah. It, maybe to like latch onto that segue, even though it's not high level, I think, funnily enough, Jay and Silent Bob are kind of the strongest parts of this, and they shouldn't be. I should just be like, that's so dumb, but I just fucking find them so super funny, man. I just, they're so ridiculous and so dumb and so 90s that I'm just like, okay, yeah, I thought I'd hate you guys, but I kind of like still kind of like you guys. I don't love them. I don't like memorize their fucking monologues and tell it to my friends in the cafeteria anymore, but it's pretty funny.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds like Benny's not on that motorcycle though.
You don't like Jay and Silent Bob, Ben? What's up?
What?
What the fuck, Ben?
Is that what you're...
That's what I heard.
Sorry, Ben.
Where the
no,
fuck
I'm asking.
Did you pull that from?
Where did you get that from,
Because when he was talking about Jay and Silent Bob, you're like,
No, I was disagreeing with the fact that he thought they were the strongest thing about this movie.
No way.
I think Jay and Silent Bob are great, but, you know, I don't know if they were the strongest part of the movie. That's all.
Fair. As normal, I'm just pulling things out of my ass and saying them out loud.
Yeah, we appreciate that. Thank you.
Yes, like a monkey flinging his feces.
Like a stink palm on a pretzel.
Like a stink palm, indeed. Well, you went there, so I guess that's the end of the show. All right, everybody.
See you later. What are your dude's high levels? Mine was grumpy because I watched a different cut that I didn't know existed.
Yeah. I guess I'll go. I didn't end up seeing this until, I think, after the turn of the century.
Wow.
Not very far, like maybe like 5 or 6 years later or something. But like when I was in my 20s, and I ended up seeing it because I don't remember what friend it was, but I had a friend that, like, you know, I feel like in my 20s, like that was when like being a nerd started to be cool. Like we all started owning the shit and, you know, being like, no, you know what? Mm-hmm. I fucking love this shit and it's cool. Fuck you, jock. You know, like that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, so like in that spirit, I remember one of my friends being like, dude, you got to see this movie, Mallrats. You got to see Mallrats. You'll love it. You got to see Mallrats. I was like, Mallrats? Why don't I watch a movie called Mallrats? Like, it wasn't conjuring. Number one, he didn't tell me it was like a Kevin Smith movie. And number two, it wasn't conjuring anything in my mind that, like, had anything to do with Star Wars or, you know, fucking comic books or video. Like, I just couldn't, like, figure it out.
Yep.
Just because I said Star Wars?
Yeah.
Jesus.
You wanted more deaths? You got it, folks. It's
getting dangerous over here on Valverde.
It really is, man. And number three, Ben, you were out of your, like, you know, mall phase of your young life at that point, probably.
It just, I just wasn't putting it. I just wasn't putting it all together. But anyways, I finally saw it. I was like, holy fuck, I love this movie. This is great. This is just, totally, you know, it ticked a lot of the, you know, perfect nostalgia boxes. And, you know, it's not like, it's not a fucking masterpiece, but I also think that, like, people pan this movie because, you know, they're coming off of Clerks and, you know, I think people fetishize Clerks a little too much because it's, I don't know, in black and white or something. I mean, it's a great movie, don't get me wrong, but, like, I don't see that much of an air gap between these, those two movies.
It's, like, definitely fetishized, man. It's a good choice of words for that.
Yeah. So, I don't know. It just, you know, it ticked a lot of the right boxes with, you know, all of the shenanigans and, you know, nerd references. And I didn't, like, laugh out loud every fucking minute watching it this time around, but it still held up for me. I still, like, really enjoyed it. Yeah.
Now I'm pissed I watched this version.
Nice high level. Yeah, I kind of feel bad for you.
It made me think about how I always used to confuse Jason Lee and Ryan Reynolds for some reason.
Oh, no doubt. Yeah, totally.
Wow.
Now I want to see a Jason Lee version of Deadpool. Maybe they should reboot.
They have a similar sort of, like, delivery with the comedic stuff, you know? Like a similar kind of attitude.
But, like, Jason Lee is more of a dickhead, and Reynolds seems like more of a nice guy, and I kind of like the dickheadishness of Jason Lee.
Yeah.
Same here. I like his Brody for sure. You know, like, when he's always, especially Brody's at the end, when he gets all wound up and he starts yelling at everybody all the time.
Totally. Brody would totally fit in like a grandma's boys type setting. Like, he's just, he really
definitely
is, like,
dude.
Absolutely.
A quintessential trope of the era.
Yeah. No question about that, man. God, he should have made a cameo in that movie. That would have been sweet.
Mm. Right. I remember seeing, Blade it was like one of the sequels to Blade or whatever that Ryan Reynolds
was in. The third terrible one with Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I was like, wow, Jason Lee's in a fucking superhero movie? Holy shit. Like,
fair enough.
Yeah. That movie. Wow. Hannibal freaking whatever. Hannibal Chew. Hannibal whatever his name was in that movie. That was pretty dreadful.
Yeah.
Bow and arrow guy. Yeah, whatever. Dumb. Anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, so wait, where do we leave off here? Chad, did you do your high level yet?
Yeah, man, it's you.
He hasn't done his third high level yet, though.
That's true.
Oh, okay, yeah. Let's do that first. Go ahead.
Elevenses.
I'll do an Elevenses. I definitely just to tack onto your high level there, Benny, like, I was definitely one of those people that loved Mallrats close to as much as Clerks. So I definitely was not in the panning Mallrats camp.
Nice.
But it definitely seems like a lot of people consider Clerks to be, like, the only good movie Smith ever made. And I disagree, but I haven't really followed a lot of the newer shit, like Jay and Silent Bob fucking 62 and, you know, Clerks 17. But, you know, back in the day, this movie and Clerks, I think, were pretty solid hits from him. Really quintessential
Dogma.
Kevin Smith stuff. Dogma was good, too. I kind of fell off the Dogma train a bit, but...
Thanks for sharing, Not-So-Silent Bob.
Yes.
That was my Elevensies.
There you go. I like that. I think it's time for second breakfast. So, I think that I didn't see this when it came out. I definitely saw it many years later. I want to say my brother turned me onto this, but I had never seen Clerks, either. I was more of a victim of people that were, like, talking about it all the time. And telling me to watch it to the point that then I was just like, now I'm never going to watch it because I am annoyed that everybody is talking about this stupid movie.
I love how much of a fucking hipster you were when you were young. You wouldn't watch Natural Born Killers.
Yeah. No, I was a total D-bag, dude. But I mean, the reality of it is that I didn't see Clerks when it came out. I heard about how great it was, and I was just like, dude, everybody shut up about that movie. And then I didn't see it for years and years and years. And right. I don't think it's not my favorite Kevin Smith at all. I didn't even really find it to be terribly funny. I think, you know what my problem with Clerks was? Is that I was those guys. I did two tours of duty working at a convenience store at a mobile gas station in two different locales. And I was just like, dude, been there, done that, man.
So did it hit too close cool. to home, or you just found it boring?
Hit too close to home, and I just done it. Like, we did those things. Like, the things that we did when we worked at those convenience stores was just very similar and
I like how you're
crazy.
Like,
oh, everyone said it's such a great movie, but fuck them. And I was a clerk before Clerks.
It's like, all right, man.
Exactly. Yeah. I was, dude. I knew this was definitely I knew about Star Wars kid before Star Wars kid knew about Star Wars kid yeah. moment, you know? And I was clerking out before Clerks was a thing, you know? So yeah. then when Clerks came out and everybody was like, dude, it's so sweet. And I was like, bro, I was one of the clerks, and it was even cooler.
You definitely had a goatee when you were doing that, too.
Oh, my God, dude. 1,000% goatee, and also bulletproof glass. You know, it was awesome, man. So, like, that was, like, a time in my life living it, man. I was like, I don't need to watch it. I lived it, you know? So, getting back more back on track, I think that...
Did you go...
Yeah, all the time.
Hey, man,
bro.
Have you seen Clerks?
Nah.
Whatever.
Somebody was like, hey,
I am Clerks.
Hey, Kev, have you ever seen Clerks?
Exactly,
and Kev just went.
Getting back to Mallrats, I think that I definitely saw it later, and I thought it was great. Like, I loved it when I saw it. I definitely enjoyed it on this watch. I had to watch it in two chunks. I had to finish it today. And when I started watching the first chunk, I definitely noted the raw quality of it.
Yeah.
But I definitely got into it by the time I had to finish watching it today. I think I did like half and half. And when I was watching it, trying to cram in the rest of my work day and simultaneously watch this movie, it was challenging, but I was really enjoying it, you know, and there was just like a lot of moments. I was like, oh, I forgot about that, man. Like, this is a great movie, you know? So, yeah, thoroughly enjoyed it for sure. It's definitely a cult movie. It's definitely a classic still. And, you know, it definitely holds up. I mean, it's kind of raw, and I mean that's kind of part of its charm, I think. You know, is that kind of raw quality?
Dare I say it was maybe a little ahead of its time? Because, like,
sure, yeah,
you know, in '95 it was probably still a little too close to home. You know, and also like it was before superhero movies or you know that nerd culture thing had really kind of taken off. So
yes,
yeah,
I agree.
Probably wasn't finding its audience.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And I think that's really well said. You probably just nailed it right there, Ben. And yeah, you know, subsequently, you know, it's sort of attained its own great cult status. But
you got like the other dialogue heavy contemporary of the time would be like a Tarantino, and like similarly gritty,
totally.
Maybe not quite as raw, but very dialogue heavy. But it was like not as nerdy. It was more cinema nerdy than like comic book nerdy. So Smith was a little bit more niche-y for sure. And I definitely agree that it was like ahead of its time. Like, comic books and shit were not fucking cool for a long time. And then they all became pretty cool in like late 90s, maybe like Matrix-y time. That's a death.
Well, yeah, I mean, look, I'll give you the death, but I mean, let's just give props to Kevin Smith for a second, dude, because I mean, he kind of helped pioneer that whole thing of nerd culture being cool. I mean, this is definitely kind of proto nerd, you know, if you want to kind of frame it. And I so that, you know, it kind of ties in with your, you know, ahead of its time comment. You know, it really kind of was, and this is definitely like not as raw as Clerks, you know, in terms of roughness, you know, but it's pretty close, man. I mean, some of the acting is pretty suspect in this. I mean, it's still good despite that, but, you know, it's still got that raw quality. And you know, Kevin, I think Kevin Smith was still kind of finding his feet with the writing, you know, but I mean, look at what he went on to end up doing. You know, like, once we get into like Dogma and Jay and Silent Bob and stuff like that, like it definitely, it gets better and it gets funnier and the writing gets a little bit sharper as he matures as a creator. You know what I mean? But he was definitely kind of carrying the torch and pushing that kind of nerd culture thing forward, man, you know, because it totally resonated with people. It resonated with people like us, even though I didn't see it in 95, like, you know, like those are us. I mean,
as a 15-year-old watching the movie, seeing a Brody and these other dudes like college-age kids, you're like, yeah, those dudes are cool, you know, even though like looking at it now, I would argue that they're not very cool. They're kind of, you know, losery fucking mall kids. But
what does Ben Affleck call him?
I don't know.
He doesn't. I want to say shiftless layabouts.
Yeah, I think you're right.
That's what
yeah.
he says.
That's a very Kevin yes. Smith phrase.
When he's kicking his ass.
Yep.
I'm a big fan of that phrase, and I think I picked it up from this movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, yeah, I mean, they're definitely shiftless layabouts. You know what I mean? They're kind of like, you know, that early 20s, like, you know, just
fuck ups.
Living with your parents, don't have to do anything, you know, driving around in an old Ford, you know, Country Squire or Vista Cruiser or whatever it was, you know, that thing was awesome. Right?
Fucking love that
thing. Was great. Yeah, so, you know, right on. I mean, I would have seen this 95, I would have been in my 20s, and then I probably saw it many years after that. So, you know, but it still resonated, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because sadly for me, I was still one of those people later into my 20s. What can I say? You know, but I did finish my thought. Like, we were kind of like all Brody. We're all TS. Like, we're all Jay and Silent Bob. You know what I mean? Like, there's a kind of, certainly for me, there's like a little bit of, you know, the old me in a lot of those characters.
Oh, definitely.
You know, so.
And I definitely have to add in the there's definitely a bit of William in me where I've never been able to see a 3D image.
God, right? Me too. And then you just get pissed and trash it.
That's
all.
It.
That's more me. That was my young me. Totally.
I love that so much. I love that was included in this. And that was, you know, just so weird that was such like a meme for the time. You
it was
know?
Huge.
Like, that there were fucking kiosks and malls with like stereographic images or stereolithic or whatever the fuck they are. But you know, it was like Dave Matthews' first album, Remember Two Things, had like a fucking a hand doing the peace sign with one of the, you know.
Oh, a 3D.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh my God, dude. I was never good at, I could never see those things,
I know,
man.
Never,
I was always, I was like, one. God, dude. I don't think it's ever to this day, but, and then I remember, I think when I first finally did see one, I was just like, that's it? Really? I was like, this is so stupid.
No, I've never to this day seen one, and it's been what's been missing for my life. It's why I've been sad my whole life. I'm convinced.
Wow. Well, you see, Chad, you gotta relax and sort of, you gotta let your eyes relax, sort of let them like cross and like stop thinking about it so much. And
take a step back, yeah.
Hey, sailboat.
Absolutely.
A schooner.
It's not a scooter.
It's a fucking dumbass.
So dumb.
So, what do you guys want to do for this? Do you guys want to just kind of bounce around?
I think we should talk about
the cast.
I think we should talk about Baphman.
Let's talk about Baphman for sure. Dude. I love that Baphman was in this movie, dude. Like, he's super fresh and young, too.
That's it. I totally didn't put two and two together until I looked at IMDb timelines that this is pre Good Will Hunting, which makes sense in hindsight. But I kind of assumed this was like just after or contemporary with his big break. So it was kind of cool to see him pre big break.
Yeah, it was. And again, you know, raw, definitely like a raw Affleck. I mean, he was kind of inhabiting a space, I think, that was either easy for him or one he got typecast into of being this kind of, he got cast in a lot of douchey roles around this time. You know what I mean? Like he was a douche in School Ties, a movie that I freaking just love.
It's a great movie.
Great movie. I just watched it like a month or two ago. He was a douche in Dazed and Confused. He was a douche in this.
And he still is.
Shall I go on?
I mean,
he's still a douche.
You could go through the whole IMDb.
I'm not on IMDb, Chad. I know you think I'm constantly on IMDb and I'm constantly on the internet and in a perpetual ejection, but I'm not.
I disagree. But you could just put douchebag after every single title in IMDb and you'd be pretty accurate.
What about Jersey Girl? Was he a douche in that? I didn't see that.
No, I haven't seen it either.
If I did, it was so long ago, I don't remember it.
To be honest, though, I just wanted to bring up Baffman just to torture Benny with a Baffman death.
All right.
Your Baffman contribution to that episode, Benny, is still one of the highlights of my life.
Every time somebody says Baffman, all I can think is Pyburn fucking doing the Baffman funny thing with a fucking picture of him, like a picture of him eating fucking a sub. Wolfing down that burger, man.
I cannot. Every so time good. I hear Baffman, all I can think about is Jarhigo laughing about Pyburn and the hamburger picture. Dude.
Check your chapter out. I'll make it chapter art for everybody.
Sometimes, you know, the perfect quote is just magical.
It really is, man.
Agreed.
It's like a Far Side or something, you know?
Yeah. Reddit has turned into a cesspool of stupidity, but sometimes those comment sections are just fucking gold.
Dude, Reddit is a cesspool of stupidity, for sure.
But the cream rises to the top on occasion, and just perfection of comments or quips shows up, and it's just the best thing ever.
Yeah, totally, man. So,
to Baffman.
Yeah, I really enjoyed, just to kind of dive in a level or two deeper on Baffman. I enjoyed his douchiness in this movie. It was spot on. He was perfect for the role of the fashionable male douche.
I love how fashionable he was in his really weird, loose fitting clothing.
I know. And his like super oddball kind of 90s ish suit jacket that was like, you know. Futuristic and hip or whatever.
Like, I'm surprised he didn't have one of those like fucking rainbow mushroom necklaces on or some shit, like, and had fucking devil sticks in his backpack or something. Like, it was the most 90s.
Dude, I hate to say it, but I pretty much had that exact same outfit.
Yes.
Not on purpose, but I pretty much had that exact same outfit, and I did have one of those rainbowy.
I had a rainbow mushroom necklace. I'm not sure.
Weather thong, rainbow. You know, mushroom thing, or it wasn't a mushroom, but you know what I mean. It was like that weird, like, yeah.
Wait, what are you guys talking about? A necklace?
Yeah, like they were the like fema clay kind of psychedelic necklaces.
Yeah,
that you could buy at like fucking Spencer's Gifts with your blacklight posters.
Yeah, it's a good alternative to the bathtub stopper drain chain. Necklace that you could also buy at
Spencer's. Wait, the bathtub stopper drain chain wallets? Is that, or is it a different necklace chain?
No, I mean, they actually had one that you could put around your neck as well.
Okay.
It wasn't just Matt DeHart's wallet chain.
Do you remember when people used to wear chains with padlocks around their necks?
Yes.
Fuck. Oh my God.
That was so dumb. I love how often black lights and Spencers are referenced in this show.
Dude.
It always makes me smile.
As a Nantucketer, there ain't no Spencer's Gifts in Nantucket. The highlight of our day is Cumbie's bumping, dude. When you could get to the mainland and see a Spencer's Gifts in fucking Cape Cod Mall, it was the best thing ever. It was like, what can I spend my money on?
I'm with you 100%, man.
What ridiculous poster can I buy right now so that when I get stoned at night and look at my glow stars on the ceiling, I can fucking super pumped while my lava lamp warms up?
Man, you are laying it down, bro. Don't stop.
All I'm doing is recalling my room.
I know, in your horrible, pathetic life growing up with blacklight posters and glow stars. I'm kidding, dude.
It was a happy time.
I think
it was a happy, sad time.
I tell you what I really like. I really like that Spencer's is still there.
Yep.
And I love that they're still catering to our exact age demographic, man.
Yep. It's and it great. Amazes me that a teen would be into it still.
Oh, my God. It's amazing, man. I go in there and I'm just like, this stuff is awesome. Dude, that's where I got my Bob Ross wallet, man. I have the best Bob Ross wallet.
You have a Bob Ross wallet?
I do. I have a Bob Ross wallet. It's basically...
I demand an image.
Oh, yeah. I'd be happy to share. It's basically a painting, and then there's a picture of Bob Ross on one side, and it's just great. It makes me smile. I get a lot of compliments on it. Hang on.
I think Bob Ross should be put on like a half dollar coin or something.
No doubt.
That would be amazing.
You know why? Because he's like a cultural icon of like.
Dude, he's like a Mr. Rogers. He's like a mythical figure.
Yeah, and being being happy and like nice.
Ex-nom vet, painting.
Did you guys watch the sort of more recent documentary about Bob Ross?
I think I did. Maybe not.
No, I didn't know there was such a thing.
Hold on, I'm like trying to.
I watched the Mr. Rogers one. How recent was it? Because I've definitely seen something.
I watched it fairly recently. I don't actually know how recent it was made, but it was really interesting. Just like he got really fucked over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like basically he was in business with these people that essentially like just stole his likeness and his name. Like, and he wasn't getting anything like towards the end, you know, end stages of his life. Like he was just getting completely fucked.
That sucks.
Yeah, yeah. Wow, I didn't realize it was like that level.
That wallet is fucking awesome, man.
It is awesome, man. And it's actually like a pretty decent wallet, too. Like, I've actually had this thing for many years now, and it's still like in really good shape, man. It's held
up. Is that your daily
well.
Carry?
Yeah. Bro, this is my daily.
That's awesome. How often did people notice it?
Often enough, like I am always surprised at who notices it as well. Like it's really the spectrum is broad. No, really. Like I'll get like if I whip that thing out when I'm what's the word I'm looking for? Transacting commerce.
What's the phrase I'm looking for? Participating in capitalism.
Yes, when I'm participating in capitalism and transacting commerce, I'll pull that baby out, and you know, I'm always surprised at who comments on it. And it's all generations. That's what makes me smile.
Yeah,
is that we've got people from all over the age spectrum enjoying Bob and his wonderful ways.
No doubt. I had the absolute pleasure of introducing Bob Ross to a girl from New Zealand once on that hike I did, where we were all just hanging out in this hotel room, and Bob Ross came on, and she was like, "Why the fuck are we watching this? I don't want to watch this bullshit." I was like, "Shh, just be quiet and watch for a minute."
That's all you
and
have
like
to do.
Three episodes later, she was like, "This is the best thing ever, man."
Like, that's like pretty much anybody. Dude.
Yes, it is.
I remember putting that on for my kids at one point. They were hooked in like 2 seconds.
No doubt.
Great.
No doubt.
Sorry, not to take away from what Jarhigo was talking about too. I've never seen that documentary. I never even heard of it, but that really
that's great.
I've heard things like that, and I've heard other things too about how he kind of landed where he was, about being like, you know, Mr. kind of peace, love, and painting, you know, and it was kind of similar to that. So now I'm really curious to check that out. What's the name of that documentary, Ben?
The only one I'm seeing is Bob Ross, the Happy Painter. I'm not sure if that is same documentary or not, but it probably is.
I kind of feel like he got fucked over by some business people and stuff, but if anyone would just be like, yeah, whatever, it would be him. He'd just be like, yeah, I'm just going to paint some paintings.
Let me change that. It is on Netflix. It is called Bob Ross, Happy Accidents, Betrayal, and Greed.
Well, there you go.
Wow. I like that title. Sounds scandalous.
It is a little scandalous. Yeah. But it was crazy. I mean, there were like Bob Ross paints and like paint supplies and, you know.
Right.
Like he wasn't getting like a fucking penny out of that shit, basically. Like they really fucked him over.
That sucks.
Yeah.
Maybe you have a contraband wallet, Kev.
I'll tell you what, I don't even think they
something tells
this.
Me the people that fucked him over aren't even getting any money out of that one.
Like. I don't think I have a number of Bob Ross items, and one of a good friend of mine who's also a fan supporter and listener of the show, I gave him a talking Bob Ross bobblehead to glue to his dashboard when I went up to see him in the fall. And that thing was great. It had a little button on it, and every time you pressed it, it would say some Bob Ross bit of wisdom. I'm actually looking for the wallet right now. I don't even think they make this thing anymore.
You had Bob Ross wallets before Bob Ross had Bob Ross wallets?
Dude, I did. I sure did. Oh, wait a second. No, out of stock at Hot Topic. Spencers. I mean, let's be real here, right? Hot Topic is like the other Spencers, right?
Yeah, dude. That was a little after my time, but Hot Topic is definitely Spencers-esque.
Oh, wow.
My favorite Spencer's gift purchase, I think, or at least the one that sticks out the most in my head, was this key ring that I got that had like 5 or 6 buttons on it and a little speaker, and it just played. It was like, you know, fuck you, you're an asshole, fucking jerk.
Yes,
I know exactly. I know that keychain.
It was
man.
Those sayings, and we just used to like sit there trying to make it sound like it was having an argument with itself. You know, like, eat shit, fuck you, fucking jerk. Like,
yes.
You're an asshole. Fuck you, fucking jerk. Eat shit. Yeah. Yeah. That is quality Spencer's purchase right there.
Oh, that is a Spencer's purchase.
Pre-internet ways to spend money. Knives Monthly magazine and Spencer's gifts.
That Knives Monthly bit was really funny because it's so damn true.
Spencer's gifts cul-de-sac adjourned.
Yeah, wow. That was worthy, though. I enjoyed every minute of that.
You know, it's kind of on topic.
It's definitely on topic. It's a mall shop. Paul Blart Mall Shop.
No, I'm not trying to bring up Hot Topic. Don't start talking about Hot Topic.
I'm not. The other Spencers.
I want to actually, no, this, I need to segue us, wow, no pun intended, into another cul-de-sac in which I reveal to the listeners at home that I am an electric scooter riding mall cop now.
What?
I needed to get to and from work, so I got one of those like electric scooters to go to and from work, and it's actually a Segway scooter. So
what?
I officially cruise a Segway.
You actually have a Segway.
I actually have a Segway scooter. And the other day, like, some of the neighbors from down the laneway were like, "Oh, we're gonna go on a bike ride," and I don't have a bike, so I fucking scooted around with these dudes, and they were calling me a fucking mall cop, and it was the funniest thing ever.
So is the configuration like a proper scooter, or is scooter, it like a Segway?
I think Segway like sold a stand-up to scooter? Some company and they just put the branding on it. It's like any electric scooter you see like around kicking around. Like, didn't they have like Lime scooters or whatever, or Bird scooters in all the cities and shit? You know what I'm talking about?
Well, I mean, like, scooters have become like a thing in terms of like renting as like electric scooters. You mean like they're
yeah, it's one of those. Yeah.
Like the little ride-on ones.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
like not the ones you sit on like a moped. Not that type of scooter. No. I'm just thinking like the kind one. Yeah, like a
not a Vespa, not the mods from fucking Boba Fett.
No, but I kind of want to be one of those.
No,
guys.
Bro. No. But you're talking like a Razor scooter.
Yeah, the nerdy
but
Razor.
But like
scooters.
Electric.
Yeah.
I demand video.
I do too. I need a pic. I need video. I want to see you with some sort of weird helmet apparatus riding that thing. And I mean, what's going on? I thought that you drove a car to work. I assumed you drove a car to work, just like the rest of us schlubs.
No, I used to have a work truck, but now that I'm in the city, it's like fucking $50 a day to park in the city or something. So I just scoot in like a nerd burger.
Oh, damn, dude. I thought you just, like, jumped in your car and, like, drove to work like I do. Dad's going to work. Like,
you didn't even get an e-bike. You got an electric scooter.
Yeah, I don't know. E-bikes? I don't know. I'm too lazy for an e-bike. I don't need an e-bike.
It's not a one-wheel, like, electric skateboard or something. It's a scooter. I love that. That's great.
If I got an electric skateboard, I'd be dead within a week.
You should do a, you know, you should do, like, a moto vlog type thing where, like, get like, a, you know, get like a GoPro and like strap it to your chest, and like while you're on your way to work, like just, you know, just record like random thoughts and stuff while you're riding your scooter.
There you go.
I strap it to my chest like the fucking alien dude from Total Recall.
Figure out a way to make it more awkward and weird.
Well, if you strap it to your chest, you have like the first person, you know.
Yeah, that's it.
View with your hands on the handlebars or whatever.
I could just put it on my sweet bike helmet or whatever that I have to wear.
There you go.
Wow. That's like peeling an onion, man. I love it.
The layers, man. The layers. So, yeah, I'm now also officially a mall cop.
Wow. I love it, dude. I'm picturing you in a white short sleeve button down.
Oh, no.
Polyester of some kind, terrible. No, not a pocket protector, but maybe it's sometimes I picture a black tie, sometimes not. Trousers, no jacket, and like a nerdy bike helmet, you know, just kind of like
sure.
Yeah.
Watch out. I'm C-Lab. Let me through.
Listening to myself on my own podcast.
Immerse.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. No, I love how fucking lame short sleeve button down shirts are. I've never owned one. I don't have the balls, I don't think, to own a short sleeve button.
Well, the old school ones are definitely lame, and you know they're very kind of.
There's new technology short sleeve button downs.
hold on.
They've got these great new fabrics.
Especially when you wear them with a tie. They're very Michael Douglas from Falling Down, kind of, you know? Makes you kind of look like a psychopath.
I don't know. Michael Douglas looked pretty badass in Falling Down, to be fair.
We have two choices of attire at work. We can either wear a branded shirt.
Embroidered polos or something?
Something. Well, yeah, kind of like that. A little bit. Yeah, we have those, and then or we can wear something nice, which is kind of like biz casual, I guess you could say.
So you wear a 70s tuxedo.
Yeah.
Brown ruffle shirted 70s tuxedo.
And by that you mean a light blue ruffle front.
Yeah.
70s tuxedo.
Can you do that sometime, please? Can you rent one of those, please? Please.
I would like that again. That's going to be like the day.
I'll put a GoFundMe together for that shit.
Dude, that would probably fill up in 2 seconds. We can't even get anybody to give us a dollar for the show every month. Oh my God. I tell you what, I think, no. So just kind of staying on point, I think that.
Staying like on topic, short sleeve t-shirt technology, short sleeve button shirt technology.
Let me rephrase that. Staying off topic.
Staying hot topic.
Yeah, short. So I'll wear a short sleeve button down with no tie and a blazer.
You know, really? I love that.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's not like a crappy white shirt. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, colored shirts or even like a print on it. You know what I mean? Wow. We're gonna have to leave that pause in there because that was pretty damn funny. I was being completely frank, and you guys were just like, bah, ma.
Are you allowed to wear short sleeve button shirts with a blazer over tie? Doesn't that open a quantum wormhole if you do that?
Well, nobody knows it's short sleeve unless I take the blazer off.
Oh, so you don't take it off?
Sometimes I do, but mostly I don't.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's kind of like a dickie.
Yeah. Not quite. But, yeah, I could see why you would think that.
That's what's similar, yeah. You know?
Well, now I want to wear a dickie.
Okay.
Blazer with a dickie.
It's not a dickie unless you're wearing fake cuffs.
Oh, ooh, dude.
Underneath the jacket. Oh, that's funny. I like that.
Oh, that is funny, man.
No, my new gig, I just wear jeans and a t-shirt. It's great. My old gig, I had to be all fancy pants.
Wow.
So I'm just scooting in on it with a t-shirt on, but it's still pretty fucking funny. I'm still mall copping out pretty hard.
Yes, I mean,
tucked in t-shirt or
tucking my t-shirt. I'm tucking my t-shirt, man.
You're not cool.
Some serious muffin top action going on.
Whoa.
I think it's kind of a, you know
what?
It's another one of those looks. It's a little like, you tucked your t-shirt in, man? Like,
that's what my dad would do.
I had your t-shirt tucked in.
Dad, you don't tuck your t-shirt in.
And I don't mean Sly Stallone. I mean my actual Robert De Niro dad.
Rodney Dangerfield?
He'd tuck his t-shirt. He'd be like, oh, I gotta tuck in my t-shirt. Otherwise, my cell phone holder would be covered up, you know?
Your dad is Rodney Dangerfield.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
If I don't tuck in my shirt, my leather man gets all tangled up in my other side, you know?
I see that. I see homies coming in, older homies with heavy-duty belt clip cell phone holders. I'm like, dude.
Dude, I don't know. I would bet money my dad probably still has a leather man on the side of his hip there. He used to have one for years, man.
Dude, I'm just going to get this out of the way. There's zero wrong with wearing a multi-tool on your belt, bro. You know
really?
I mean? Yeah, I don't have a problem.
I don't know, man. If you want a multi-tool, good for you, bro. Throw it in your pocket.
In your pocket?
You really? Belt multi-tools?
Are we really having this conversation?
I think we need to, man. Benny, chime in. Is a belt multi-tool an acceptable apparel?
Why not? It's an item that can be used virtually anywhere by anyone. I mean, it could save a life.
It could also prevent a date.
I've never done it myself. I'm not super judgy about it, but I've never been one to carry. I don't even like wear jewelry, really, so, or even a watch. So, you know, like the idea of carrying like a, you know, a Leatherman or a knife or, you know, that kind of shit every day just doesn't really.
Yeah.
It's not my bag, but it depends on how you do it. You know, like if you're making a show out of it, like you said, if like you're tucking in your shirt just so that like, you know, your cell phone holder and your fucking Leatherman are like on display, you know, then you got a problem there, I think. But yeah, you know, if you just carry it around in your pocket or whatever, then who fucking cares, you know?
I like it.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm not judgy about it either, man, because I used to carry one when I was a tradesman, but I don't wear one currently. I do carry a knife in my bag, but I like Ben, not judgy about it. You know what I mean? It's like I see people with Leathermans, and they could be from all walks of life, and it's like, all right, yeah, you got a multi-tool in case you need it for freaking dialing shit in and being MacGyver, dude. That, like, that's totally acceptable in my mind.
I guess I am judgy about it, and I think that's funny considering that I ride a mall cop scooter to work.
Yeah, hello. And then just to comment on
sorry, this, not that,
to riff off Ben's jewelry comment, I don't really wear jewelry per se. I did just get a hold of a very sweet retro Casio watch about a year ago, and I wear that every day. And I just sent a picture of it.
That's
love
pretty
it.
Sick.
Yeah, I'm jealous,
it's,
man.
It's awesome.
I've been dreaming about buying a like really super vintage, like red LED, you know, fucking watch, like the kind that don't even stay on, like you have to like press the button and then it shows you the time kind of a thing.
Yes, definitely, dude. Those are hot, and I have seen those.
There's some great ones out there, but
yeah, I just want something that tells the time and the date, you know. So I saw that these were on Kohl's. I did a little bit more digging and found that they make a ton of these retro kind of Casio watches, man, including various different colors of the calculator watch, the classic, and a bunch of the metal ones, too, in gold and in
I was going to say, you should rock a gold one, dude.
I went on the Casio site and found all kinds of vintage and classic ones, and they got some really cool gold ones as well. I was
definitely, get your Freddie Mercury stash going again, get yourself a gold Casio, and fucking bada bing, bada boom.
I do. I just reshaped my stash into a Freddie Mercury.
Nice.
Dude, I just got a high and tight haircut to go with my stash, so.
Did you really?
Oh, yeah.
Nice, dude.
Oh, love yeah. It. That wasn't really I intended, but it's what I ended up with.
But here we are.
Don't you love that, man? I love when that happens, when you're like, this is not at all what I envisioned, but I really like it a lot.
Love it.
Right?
It's all right, man. I intended, like, something a little edgier, you know, like I brought in this picture of Josh Ohm and it's, you know, not a mohawk, but it's kind of like shaved on the sides and like longer on the top. Mm. And I ended up with a cop haircut, basically. No, it's not. But with the mustache, it definitely, you know,
yeah,
looks a little copy.
Copy. I like it.
Yeah.
That's good, man. I so like that. It's a great story. I'll tell you what. Yeah.
Dude, you're so SWAT now, bro.
I could totally pull off like a cop look. I have a high and tight, but with long on the top hair. I could make that cop. I could make that cop, dude.
I love it. I love how we've just gone. We were like in a housing development and turned off into a cul-de-sac that had another cul-de-sac off of. It's like a fractalization of cul-de-sacs.
And then we fell into the drain at the end of the cul-de-sac.
That's it.
Transported to another neighborhood. Totally.
Bob Ross is in there painting a fucking painting.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what's better, that or the fact that we've talked about like 5 minutes of the movie. It's been this whole like. Hour and 17 that we've somehow managed
and
to
and four of those minutes we're talking about Ben Affleck,
and usually we're like wrapping up at this time and we haven't even started the movie. should we swing back to Baffman and then the rest of the movie or what?
I don't know, bro. Let's
Chad's like, I don't know, I kind of want to go
back to Baffman.
I forgot about I forgot about like the sex tape at the end.
Yes.
Oh my god, man. I was just dying laughing on that.
It was so funny,
who's
man.
Favorite new kid? Call me Joey.
That. Call me Joey. I'm Donnie. I'm Donnie.
Who can do something? Call me Donnie.
Perfect. And then he drops one of the like lines from one of their songs. And I can't remember what it was, but it was really funny.
Like, don't go away, girl, or whatever. But yeah.
Yes, god. That was it.
I was dying laughing at that.
That's the thing about Kevin Smith is
call
like
me Joey.
It's got its moments. Like there's just gold in here sprinkled throughout. The dialogue's kind of all over the place. Like you said, Kev, he's still trying to find his feet, and it just sounds like sometimes it sounds like every character is just Kevin Smith talking, which is a little bit annoying about some, you know, writing styles. But there's fucking gold from time to time, man, and that is a great example.
I agree. I think it's just about kind of refinement and finding that kind of nerd footing or embracing it, you know what I mean, a little bit.
Yeah.
But I definitely, like, there were parts of it, like, you know, the chocolate-covered pretzel scene, like, that's sort of kind of one of the famous kind of scenes from this movie, and I don't know, I kind of got tired of people talking about it, but, like, when I watched it today, I was just like, man, this is a great scene. Like, the whole thing's funny, because Rooker just really brings it.
He goes for it.
Freaking, man, he brings it hard in this movie. Yeah. And during that scene, he just brings it. It's so great.
Yeah, no doubt. It's
you know, the way him and Brody are kind of cozying up to each other and all that stuff. Sorry, what were you going to say, man?
Yeah, no. One good turn deserves another.
Exactly.
I, too, hope to come loud, preferably in a 69.
I know, it's like they're best buddies. That was funny. And it played well with, like, the whole, like, TS-hating thing, too, you know?
Yeah. Rooker's fucking amazing in this, man. He's great, but he's just really fucking great in this.
He was so great. Always been such an underrated talent, you know? And then he finally started getting some, like, recognition with, like, Walking Dead and Yondu and all that. And I was psyched about that because I always thought he deserved it.
Yeah, no doubt. I was watching a clip from a Comic-Con or something, you know? And, like, people were asking him questions. And somebody was like, so can you still eat chocolate pretzels? And he's like, oh, yeah. I love chocolate pretzels. He's like, I get the Godiva ones all the time. I'm not doing a product price one, but I get the Godiva ones all the time, and I'll just sit there and eat the whole can.
I love it. Seems like he's just a solid fucking dude.
Yeah, I really, I wouldn't even attempt to do a Rooker from this. It's so damn good, though, man.
It super bummed me out that they killed Yondu off in the second GOG.
Yeah, but he had a Klingon death. He had a worthy death.
Oh, definitely.
You know, and I was stoked about a worthy death.
It was
got
an awesome
worthy
story moment, like super sad and amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing moment in the movie, but he's
no
such
doubt.
An awesome character.
Yeah. He was great. He was great.
Yeah, maybe they could do like a prequel with him or something.
Yeah, that would be great, man. It was good to see him for a second in Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
I would love that. That was funny.
I'd love them to do like a Yondu fucking space pirates show. That'd be amazing.
Oh my god, Ben, this Armatron shit is so tight.
Yeah, right?
Oh my god, I gotta have one of these.
They're very reasonably priced.
And they look pretty quality. Sorry, Chad. Sorry about that. And they come in multiple colors.
Oh, yeah.
Like the uber stupid sort of, what
the
do you call that?
The rainbow one?
Yeah, what is that called? What is that metal called?
I'm not sure what that is, but yeah, it's like when you like, it's like what happens to like a chrome exhaust after it gets hot. It gets that sort of like rainbowy sheen
on
it. Like,
yes, exactly. Wow.
Yeah, it's kind of silly, but it's really actually tight. I do like it.
I like that a lot. I would definitely get that. I mean, does it just do the time, or does it also do like?
Yeah, I think it's just the fucking, just a big time.
37 millimeter iridescent. 29 millimeter.
I gotta be honest with you. I'm feeling this like black metal one with the white.
I really
like that.
Focus,
that
Tiffany.
Tight, that is tight. That is tight.
All right. We're getting a Focus Trinity Tiffany from Chad.
I think I would get the silver one with the red numbers for like going out, and I would get the black one with the white numbers for like work.
Oh, interesting.
Hmm.
Yeah, the black one's a little subdued for work. I need a little more bling for my work wrist. Maybe a goldie.
For a simple carpenter like myself, you know.
Well, I'm just a simple carpenter.
Do you need more bling than your pasty arms and your short sleeve button down?
Well, yeah, dude. I mean, I've got to offset that with a subtle, subtle something like a '80s Casio watch.
You need something to set off your long sleeve dickie with your fake cuffs.
Mm-hmm.
Boom! Nailed it. There you go.
Get you some blue blockers, okay, dude.
Yeah, there you go, man.
Ferraris.
So Michael Rooker, Yondu, Space Pirates miniseries reaction, and then we'll move on.
Yeah. Michael Rooker, awesome, awesome, awesome in this movie. That's it.
Cool.
Ben's looking at Armatron still. No guff.
I could say Michael Rooker is awesome again if you want me to.
Go ahead.
I think I already did. Oh, again? Okay. Michael Rooker is really awesome. He's great.
I gotta say something, man. This calls for a BK Whopper death, bro.
You reckon? Yeah, you guys are off on fucking Digiwatch land.
Yes.
It's a BK Armatron.
Could it be the Big King instead?
Ooh, I'm gonna do that.
Which is like the Burger King version of the Big Mac.
Yeah, I like that. I'm going to put the Armatron home of the Big King. How's that?
Ooh, very nice. I like that. Thank you.
We've got the Big Mick.
Chicken McNibbles.
Cool. Well, we're in the world's shortest show because the last 30 minutes will be cut out.
Oh, stop it, dude. Guide us, Chad. Where should we go next?
I think Jeremy London. I've kind of get him and Brendan Fraser confused a lot, man.
Yeah, that's I can see that.
Yeah, they've done similar movies. They both did A Journey to the Center of the Earth. They've both done kind of some similar properties. I think it's definitely part of it.
Yeah.
I couldn't think of anything that I had seen him in besides this.
Same.
I don't know. I mean, let's see. His brother did Dazed and Confused. And then
I love how often
we come
across identical twin sibling actors in this fucking show that we do.
Like, who else? What do you mean?
Sarah Connor. Remember we dropped that
nugget? That was a surprise. I didn't even know that until we did that episode.
Hmm.
You're right, though. Arnold Schwarzenegger, Danny DeVito, obviously.
Obviously.
Of course. Of course.
What else?
Today is your day, bro.
You know what? I need a quick little break. Hang on. Actually have covered a lot of it. Yeah, we got to talk about Stan Lee and that whole thing, you know.
And how Claire Forlani is like at a fucking 15 out of 10.
Yeah. Okay, so everybody, Chad wanted to talk about how Claire Forlani... I'm kidding. What else has she done that's notable that we would know?
I know her from Meet Joe Black, which is a really weird, obscure...
Yeah, that is a weird movie. I thought that was the other thing that I saw her in. But
she was in Mystery Men, apparently.
Ooh.
Wait a minute. What?
Wait a minute.
Oh, yeah, she did. Stay she played the waitress, target. Right? At the diner?
Oh, she's in Basquiat as well, which is another super fucking niche movie.
But yeah, she's had an interesting swath of roles. I don't know. I felt like she was kind of Woody in this one.
I was kind of Woody in this one.
Oh my God, that is so getting cut, dude.
Oh,
that was terrible.
Oh.
Oh.
Yeah, she was the waitress in Mystery Men that like Mr. Furious was trying to pick up.
Yes. Boom. There you go.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I was just watching Claire Forlani videos in mute.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God. All right. So I thought that she was a little wooden in this. As was Jeremy London, to be perfectly frank.
He totally was, man.
He was extremely wooden in this. So, yeah, I don't know. Again, yeah, she's had a really interesting swath of roles, like the movies we just covered. This, Mystery Men, Basquiat, Meet Joe Black. I mean, that's definitely an odd bunch.
No doubt.
And then Jeremy London has sort of doppelganged Brendan Fraser's career with some similar IPs and so forth.
He was good in The Mummy.
I think his brother... Yeah, wait, what?
Yeah?
He was good in The Mummy?
Mm-hmm.
No, Brendan Fraser was good in The Mummy.
Yeah, that was the joke.
Oh, wow. That's enough for somebody. I think it's I call that a Calvin Klein death.
Yeah.
Chad and Kev dead together. All right, so... yeah, what else? Anything else about those two, or should we...
Nah. I think it's worth maybe just, like, tying that one in a bow that, like...
You love Claire Forlani. We get it.
Mm-hmm. No, just that, like, I don't know. I mean, it felt very George Lucas-y here, where, like, I think some of this was, you know, the directing, you know, Kevin Smith just not really being able to get...
The actual actors he wanted?
Maybe I'll just cul-de-sac us again, because why the fuck not? There's this dude, Patrick H. Willems, on YouTube, who makes, like, really fucking long-winded videos. Like, each of them are, like, an hour long about stuff. And he made one about Kevin Smith, where he was talking about how Kevin Smith really sucks as a cinematographer.
Wow.
And just, like, doesn't have any skills. And I guess Bruno fucking yelled at him once because he didn't know how, like, certain lenses work, like, on a set. Bruno was like, dude, you need to fucking know this shit, man. And
Bruno as in Bruce Willis, our Bruno?
As in Bruno, yeah, Bruce Willis. And I guess, wow. Like...
All right.
I guess, like, this Patrick Willems dude on YouTube, he's, like, a filmmaker himself, and so he talks about things a bit more technically, and he's just like, Kevin Smith always does wide two shots and wide four shots for people, and, like, because he doesn't know how to block scenes.
Mm.
And it was interesting because he was showing these clips, and it's just, like, a shot with all five people in the cast, like, talking and bantering with each other. And how the fact that you're not closing in on people with the camera makes it feel like a really wooden performance. And I feel like there's definitely some of that here.
Ah, okay. I see where you're going with that. Yeah.
And I think TS and Brandy both, like, are super wooden characters. But I also feel like it's you know, Kevin Smith just not knowing how to shoot stuff because he was, you know, very guerrilla filmmaking or something. So.
Sure.
Yeah. This was also his second movie. And
yeah, for sure.
His first movie with any kind of budget. So I think he was probably a little out of his depth.
Yeah.
Totally.
No doubt. Yeah. No doubt.
Yeah.
So maybe I'm defending Jeremy London and Claire Forlani a little bit, but they definitely were wooden as well. So it just kind of reminded me of Attack of the Clones. You know, you get like fucking the Padmé and Anakin scenes where it's just like, this is seriously the worst acting I've ever seen in my fucking life. And, you know, Natalie Portman's a good actor, you know? So, like, sometimes it's just the way that the thing's shot or something, so.
Well, yeah, and the combination of the poor direction and, like, the bad dialogue, too, can really kind of drown an actor out, you know what I mean? Or kind of make bread soggy with milk, as it were.
It's possible that he was also literally copying Lucas's direction style, which is like faster, more intensity.
Yeah, he may. Like, what? Yeah,
he's quoted as like, you know, that's, you know, when actors ask him for like, you know, how is it? Should we change anything? And he's like, faster, more intensity.
Okay,
that's so George, so literally George Lucas, right on.
Yeah,
interesting.
Faster, more intensity.
I totally forgot Shannon Doherty was in this.
Yeah, I did too, man. Wow, she talk about a controversial person. She's a She's lit a bunch of fires.
Yeah, there's definitely not many fans of her kicking around.
No,
she seems like she got caught up in that tabloid bullshit where they were like, let's just make this chick the bad girl. And everyone write fucking magazine articles about how much everyone hates her. It's like, okay.
I don't know. She seemed to somewhat embrace it. Or she started fighting against it. That just made it worse.
Yeah, maybe.
In the most literal sense of pouring gas on the fire. I don't know. She was definitely a controversial figure in the 90s for sure. But you know, it was good to see her, man. I mean, she's definitely certainly has her place in her performances, man, and it was you know, good to see her in the movie.
She was terrible.
Yeah, she's of an era for sure.
Yes.
Who else? Really stoked to see Stan Lee in this movie. Like, man, you know, and again, just kind of going back to the whole kind of comic book thing, it was like cool to see Stan Lee when nobody was really giving a shit about comics or Stan Lee. You know what I mean? Like, obviously way, way before Marvel movies came out and started doing all that stuff, you know, it's like, I don't know. It was just cool to see him and for him to have such a cool role, you know what I mean? Because I was trying to think, like, what is this movie really about? You know, like, I mean, it's all well and good. Like, we're hanging out at the mall. It's hijinks with Jay and Silent Bob. Like, what is this movie really about? You know, and it's, I guess you could kind of say that it's really about, you know, these two schlubs and their girlfriends. And, you know, the whole Stanley part is great, man. That whole, like, speech that he gives him up to and including the kind of, you know, the reveal that it was, like, a setup by T.S. So,
yeah.
You know, I don't know. That was a really good scene. Anybody?
Bueller? I totally agree.
It's, including, you know, Jason Lee not being able to stop asking questions about, you know, like, you know,
sexual organs.
Is the thing's dork like all orange and lumpy like the rest of them? Or like,
so funny, man. So funny.
Yeah.
Made out of orange rock.
Yeah.
But so that Star Wars banter and Clerks and the superhero banter here, like the Lois and Superman thing, Kryptonite condom, like it was just super funny at the time, man. I remember just I loved it.
Yeah. No, I think it was good because I think that was, you know, again, like this is the whole part of the nerd culture conversation we were having a little while ago. Like this stuff was stuff that like all nerds talked about, you know what I mean? Or at least thought of, you know, separately on their own, you know? So. It had to be put in there at some point, you know what I mean? If not this movie, then another one, you know? So it was great that it kind of like got out in the open like that, you know what I mean? Like and especially how in depth they go, like the whole thing about Wonder Woman and her womb being strong enough, like those conversations are great. I mean, there's definitely some great dialogue and conversations in this, you know what I mean? I was super stoked. And I know Benny was too, I'm sure, to see, you know, a little Sega Genesis with the NHL hockey game featuring the Hartford Whalers. I was like,
oh my
yeah,
God,
baby.
Man. Yeah. And he was playing, it's great that he was playing the Whalers. Like,
right. And he was crushing Vancouver 12-3. Yeah. It was awesome. Yeah. That was really great.
That was a great scene too, where he was just like, you don't understand.
Yeah. You don't understand.
Opportunities don't come along that often. It's like, bro, it's a Genesis game, man.
Yeah, you can queue it up any old time, bro.
Well, you clearly had it going the night before, paused it, and then just slept on it.
I have done that.
I've done it too, man.
Back in the day, yeah. Back in the day when there weren't checkpoints or saves. Totally.
Oh, my God. Right? Those were the good old days of gaming.
Dude, someone fucking... I'll see if I can dig up the video, but someone showed, I saw a video the other day that was like, if you hold down select or some shit when you die your last death in Super Mario Brothers on NES, it takes you back to the level you died on. So if you died on like level 8, your last death, and then you hold down select and you start a new game, it starts you on 8-1. And like, someone posted this shit on Reddit. And, like, all the comments were like, what the fuck?
Oh, man. All these years later.
Yeah, finally. Like 40 fucking years later, dude. I love it. I love how everyone was just like, you got to be fucking kidding me, man.
That's right. They still haven't found the jetpack in Grand Theft Auto 5.
Dude, I still haven't beat Super Mario 1. I think I've made it to 8-4. I don't know if I've ever beaten it.
Oh, dude, I don't think I ever beat that. I definitely beat the original Metroid, but not that.
Still haven't found the jetpack.
No, still haven't found that damn jetpack. I think, what was I going to say? Man, I this kid came into work today and he was rocking this little handheld game unit that was basically looked exactly like an original Game Boy. It had black and white games of the original Game Boy, like all like in the unit. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Same setup. Like it was sweet.
That's cool. Did you beat him up and take it?
I wanted to, but I couldn't. His mom was there.
So I just dated her. No, like, I'm your stepdad now. Give me your Game Boy.
Myself. I'm your stepdad.
Screen time limit. Hand it over.
And now I'm imposing a screen time limit. Hand over your Game Boy.
Love it.
Yeah, good times. All right, next cast member. Who would that be?
Joey Lauren Adams. I love Joey Lauren Adams.
I love her, man. She's a very fetching female, number one. And number two, I always thought she was kind of underrated, dude. She was great in Dazed and Confused, great in this. Like, she's been great in Biodome, dude.
Yeah, man. Biodome and Dazed and Confused, man. Fuck yeah.
Totally. And, you know, she's done quite a bunch of other stuff as well. And she's very capable. And, again, never really thought she got her sort of due credit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, definitely a fan. And she was great in this, man. She kind of brought a little acting muscle to kind of glue this together.
Yeah, awesome. She was really funny, man. She had some great lines. Like,
yeah, she is funny.
Just, like, fucking trying on underwear, like, in the fucking store. Now, like,
oh, I love that. Yeah,
while she's talking to, like, funny, Brody and fucking TS. Yeah, it's just, like, great stuff with her.
Yeah, super matter of fact, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Gotta love that. What else? Let's see. Ethan, I've
tried
shout
to screw
out to
me
Ethan
in an uncomfortable place. What, like the back of a Volkswagen?
No, that was funny. It was funny. It didn't get old either. I was just like, all right, I'm still with it. You know, yeah. I like that.
Yeah. That joke came up like five times and it was great every time.
Exactly. I think, shout out to Ethan Suplee, man. I like him. I've always liked him. He's gone on to do some interesting stuff, as a performer. And he's funny in this as the sailboat staring 3D object in mm-hmm. the picture guy, for sure.
What else has he been in, man? I definitely know him from something.
Shoot. He did something, like, large and recognizable, and it's escaping me what it was at this moment, and I really don't feel like ejecting.
Oh, Boy Meets World. That's probably where I know him from.
Yeah, he did that, but, like, there's something else. And then he's done some edgier movies and stuff, and then he lost a bunch of weight. He's still out there rocking it, so big ups to him, man.
Rock and roll, bro.
Yeah, yeah. What else? I don't know. I got to say, like, I always thought Jason Mewes is funny, man. I know he seems like a bit of a train wreck in real life, but, like, he's pretty much
out.
Well, did he? All right, well, good. I'm glad.
Yeah,
I mean,
he finally has, yeah.
Yeah, he's definitely kind of him in these movies, and I think that that's great. And he's funny. It's just funny. I cannot laugh at him, man. He just makes me laugh. He's funny in this. He's great in Dogma, Chain Silent Bob Strike Back. Like, he's just funny, man.
Totally.
His antics are great. And he's just so committed to it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Dude, the little, like, the, like, blueprint, like, fucking, you know, the blueprints for their plans to, like, take down the stage, and his, like, his narration of those blueprints is
awesome.
Fucking amazing. Yeah. It's just fucking so good.
Biggity bam. Totally.
Yeah. Biggity bam. Stage goes damn. Snoogs.
And the snoochies, man. So good.
Fly, fat ass, fly. I guess Smith almost died doing that Batman thing on the rope.
Yeah, wow. Shocker, dude.
No, I guess the rope started slipping and he was on a crane and some crane operator dude, like, lost the keys to the crane and he was just fucking dangling up there.
Wow.
You get down
from
that, pops one in the face.
To say the least, yes.
Three nipple lady? I forgot about her.
Oh, man.
Dude, Priscilla Barnes?
Oh, exactly. I was going to drop that as a nug, but there's no point now. Yeah, Priscilla Barnes, man. Just great. I loved her from Three's Company. She's great, gorgeous, all that. And she's great as as the fortune teller in this.
I'll take a death for not knowing she was in Three's Company.
You can't have one.
Are there any John? I feel like we should do a John Ritter movie. Are there any John Ritter movies?
Yeah, Sling Blade.
Mm-hmm.
Love it.
There are others. Now, did she take over for Suzanne Summers?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, I thought Problem so. Child.
I couldn't remember if it was that way or the other way around, but what?
Problem Child. That'd be a good one. Those movies were terrible.
Oh, they were terrible. I don't know. We'd have to be in the right, like, energy space for those, man, or I think that would be a disaster.
Be a Mom and Dad Save the World. That was, you know. Was
well, yeah, but see, Mom and Dad Save the World was great because we abandoned all hope, and then we just got so hooked in on that Jerry Maguire thing.
That was the best.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's what made that episode great, dude. You know, it's kind of like... Go ahead.
Need some good snoochie-boochie-noochies for a movie like that.
Yeah there you go. That might be might be worth it. Scoob snacks. Who else in the cast? Or should we talk? You want to sit on Priscilla Barnes for a second?
Just the scene is hilarious, man, because the turnaround of it, like, you know, like Brody's going in because he's like all down for the titty show and like they're both totally skeptical. And like all of a sudden, like T.S. is like, wow, really? Like he's like totally in on the thing. And then at the same time, Brody's just like, oh, my God, he's like completely disgusted by the third nipple.
Yeah.
It's great. It's a strawberry gummy bear or whatever.
Yeah. And she pops it off and eats it. It's the best part, man. Yeah. Works every time.
Yeah.
So good. Next. That's it. Is that it for cast members? It kind of is.
It's sort of a cameo, man, but Brian O'Halloran has like some of the fucking funniest shit in this movie, like the fucking the jackhammer line, like
you're talking about the guy that plays Gil from Clerks.
Yeah, the guy that plays exactly, yeah.
Yeah, he's funny. He definitely was funny.
A jackhammer. I'm in there with some pressure. When I'm finished, you're not the same. You're changed.
Oh, man. Scary.
It's just like, fuck, man?
I know. And then like, I don't know. Yeah, he was really good. Like, his hair, like, the whole thing. His whole getup and the name. And then, you know, like, his whole, like... Dancing by the beach until the sun comes up. I was like, that is so Basket of Fries, bro. I loved it.
And then I take you to an opera, probably Deflator Mouse.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I was like, oh boy, where's the Basket of Fries? Really good stuff, man.
You gotta shout out the View Askew extended universe as well. The fact that Gil was Dante's cousin and, you know, all of the movies interconnect. Like, it's the original MCU, and I love it.
Mm.
Yeah.
No, I'm with that, man. I love stuff like that. I would say, I think this is important, too, because they made the effort to do so, is that the perhaps the final character that we talk about is the mall itself. You know, like, they really made the setting, like... a thing in this movie. And I like the fake names of all the stores. I love the debates about the various different geography of the mall, food court, you know, autonomous mid-mall snacking. You know, like, all that stuff was great. Man. You know, like, because at that point, rug munchers, fashionable male, like, whatever the cookie place was called, too, had a funny name. That's a cookie or something like that. I don't know. I just liked all that. I thought it went well, and I liked that they made the effort to kind of like make fun of malls and mall culture in general, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Especially now that malls are kind of like, you know, on the way out in most places.
Malls are dead, man.
I don't know about that, man. Mall the one that we got down not. Here is the one we have here is pretty jamming still.
I think in certain areas, like the Cape Cod Mall is still jamming. Like, it's, you know, like, I mean, it's never been very big, but it's still, like, it's still there. And there's still, like, all the stores are still open and, you know.
Yeah, agreed. I think, too, it depends on the area as well. And also, like, the kind of the effort they put in. Like, the one down here, they dialed it all in with, like, you know, freshied up the furniture and the look and, like, the little... you know, areas to kind of sit and hang out, and there's like charging ports everywhere and like, you know, like that kind of stuff. Like, so they definitely made an effort with it, and they've upgraded, like, you know, there's family restrooms now, which, you know, as a parent of young kids, I was definitely stoked for that. And, you know, more just like amenities that are kind of updated amenities. You know what I mean? It's not like still living in the late 80s. So,
yeah, I kind of miss the days where they were like, you know, brick and dark and they had like weird water features and like plants and colored lights and you could smoke and.
Where was that,
dude? Yes. The smoking. Totally.
Stranger Things kids walking around.
Yeah, remember
Hey, man, I was one of those kids.
Totally. Me too,
bro. That was definitely a thing you did.
Do you remember when McDonald's had those, like, little weird tin ashtrays? They were, like, hardened aluminum foil, and then they were, like, they were either, like, sort of saucer-shaped, or they had those, like, kind of almost, like, pleated around the edge, you know?
Yeah.
Like a cigarette-sized pleat.
Totally.
Yeah, totally disposable. Yeah. I don't know, man. It just kind of jumped into my head because Ben mentioned smoking in the mall, and I was like, wow, I forgot you used to be able to do that.
Oh, yeah.
Go to any restaurant, yeah, there's a fucking cloud of smoke on one side.
Oh, my God. I know.
But part of the appeal of this movie is just like, you know,
just the nostalgia.
Calling back to the nostalgia for like that mall culture and hanging out and, you know, like that's just like, it's a dying thing for sure. And it's kind of a shame, I think.
I don't know about that.
Pretty strong, but.
I mean, remember in like the 90s or the early 2000s, like they were whenever they built Mall of America in Minnesota, like that, it's like the biggest mall on the face of the planet.
But the whole point of this outer space. The whole point of this is Brody is fucking super pumped about how everyone at the mall knows him and they're making the movie's making fun of him for it. So like it's not saying that malls are dead. It's just saying that like thinking malls are cool is funny.
Right.
And I dig that, you know.
Yeah, I dig that too.
There was a moment when it was cool and then we all lived in that moment and then that moment passed. And taking the piss out of it in this movie, I think, was super, you know, accurate and on the nose.
Yeah, right on. I still dig malls.
I still dig malls too. Yeah. They're funny, but
they were cool for a minute,
and they're not cool anymore. They're kind of like retro cool because it's like so bad it's good. They're so uncool. They're cool.
I guess so. I mean, they've kind of the one that we have has been updated, so it's just I don't know. It's got more like. Amenities now and like things that make more sense.
I love the mall, bro.
Well, yeah, I mean the malls that are like doing well are great, but when you go to like we used to go to the Crystal Mall in Waterford, Connecticut all the time. That was like the one we used to go to.
There you go.
And I went there with my brother like one of the last times that I was home because he wanted to go to like an FYI or something and like
what do you mean recently?
Grab some DVDs. Yeah, one of the more recent trips.
Wow.
And it was like dead. Man, like there was nobody there. Like the parking lot was like all cracked pavement with like plants growing up through it. I mean, it looked like fucking post-apocalyptic, really.
Wow. I love
it. You know, like I wanted to, like 70% of the stores were probably closed. Like it was
that is terrible, man.
It was weird, man. It was really weird. I was like, fuck, man. We used to fucking just hang out there all the time when we were kids, you know, and just like see it in that state of like, you know, just dying, like barely being kept alive. Like, I don't know, it's weird.
Wow. I just pulled that up on the map. I wanted to see where exactly that was. That's like, wow, that's way down by the shore, actually.
Yeah.
Sort of, yeah.
But I like how what we're actually discovering here, Kev, is that you are still a mall rat.
You could say that, yeah. I mean, I definitely do some commerce at the mall. I wouldn't say it's a ton, but like it's what I was trying to say before was that like not only have they updated the amenities, but like, you know, for people like us that have kids now, Chad, like you've got like, you know, the indoor jungle gym place, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like there's like an actual playground at the mall now. They installed it, you know, like stuff like that. So it's not, there's other things to do there besides just go and sit there and
eat cookies.
As Ben, my favorite Ben Affleck line in this movie is, I don't like people that don't have a shopping agenda. Oh, that freaking killed me, dude. That and Shiftless Layabouts, you know? So, like, You know, it's like if you don't have a shopping agenda, like you can go there and it's actually like, you know, kind of a pleasant place to go. You know, certainly where we are, you know, the mall down here, updating it and so forth.
No doubt.
Yeah. I mean, in general, it's I like to engage in a bit of, you know, brick and mortar commerce, like whenever I'm able to just, you know, it's fun to just go around and look at shit. You know, it's not the same. Like, it's convenient to buy shit online, but like, it's not the same kind of experience. You know, it's not like that, just that like window shopping, you know, walking around, checking shit out kind of thing, you know,
or
going into a fucking Spencer's and playing with the fucking stupid keychain for an hour.
Annoying
the living shit out of the people that work in there, you know?
Absolutely, man. Or you're
like just those kinds of experiences. You're not getting that online, you know, like you got to go somewhere to do that.
No doubt, man. No doubt. And I think that, shit, just lost my train of thought.
Oh, sorry.
It's not you, man. It's not you. It's me.
Were you going to bring up another family friendly mall amenity or?
Change rooms, man. The fucking change rooms.
Maybe something about the Easter bunny. It's kind of.
Dude,
we're a little late for that, but
beating the shit that Jay's talking about beating the shit out of the Easter Bunny is pretty good. Maybe this is a good segue into Bits and Bobs.
That was great,
Bits and Silent Bobs.
Ooh, I like that. Bits and Silent Bobs.
Bits and Silent Bobs. Excellent.
Benny, you could be the Silent Bob. You tend to not really participate in the Nuggets, Deaths, Ratings, Bits and Bobs stuff. You could just sit there.
I participate in Bits and Bobs. I don't participate in Nuggets, Deaths, Ratings.
Don't be a hater. You know what?
Don't be a hate. Was that hate?
Sorry, no. Chat.
I did not recognize that as hate.
Let the hate flow through you.
I was kidding, man. Bits and Silent Bobs. Let's do it. What do you got? I probably don't have many at all.
I love Brody's indignant tirade about the kid that was playing on the escalator, and then in the middle of his fight in front of the comic book store, like the security guards take off because they had to rescue a kid that was stuck in the escalator.
Oh my god, I totally forgot about that, man, and I didn't pick up on it on this viewing.
Yeah, it's good.
Maybe this movie is where my irrational fear of my children on escalators comes from.
It's real.
I picked it up from
maybe
Brody.
It does, man.
It's real. At the time was dating a girl who had like a, you know, 4-year-old kid, and like she wanted to go get her nails done or something. So like it was just me and her kid in the mall, and he's like a really good kid and really smart, but kind of like a fucking loose cannon, you know, like was just running everywhere like to check shit out, you know. I'm like, whoa.
Slow down, bro.
Literally went up and down an escalator with him like fucking 14 times because I didn't want him to be alone.
Fair enough.
He just would not stop. Like, he just, like, as soon as we got up, he'd go back down.
Man. Well, like, barefoot's a thing in Australia over here, which really kind of freaks me out a bit. But, like, you'll go into a supermarket or, like, a fucking Home Depot equivalent, and they'll just be like, 10% of the population is barefoot. And you're just like, what are you guys doing? And so, like, a lot of kids fucking go around barefoot in, like, the shopping malls and stuff. And so, like, my kids, you know, we'll do that. And, like, my kid will be on a fucking escalator with his bare feet. I'm just like, I'm watching his fucking toes like a hawk. You know what I mean? I'm like, there's no way your fucking feet are getting anywhere near any of the seams in this fucking thing.
Kev?
What are you looking at, Kev?
You're gonna hate me when I tell you. When Ben was talking about the crystal ball, on the computer.
You like Google Street Viewing down the fucking road?
And then I clicked on it over to a Wikipedia article about it. And it said that it was said, making it Connecticut's 9th largest mall. And then, of course, I went, I wonder what the other larger malls are in Connecticut.
Dude, what the fuck?
And then I scrolled down and I'm like, whoa. I'm so sorry.
You're such a fucking lost cause, man. Love it.
Oh, man. Well, you know.
Wait, the best part is I scroll down and I go, ooh, there's a shopping mall in Connecticut portal.
Oh my god.
I was about to click on it when you said, what are you doing?
Like, oh, shopping malls.
Ooh. Why, don't mind if I do.
God, wow. What a terrible fate I had.
Well, it wouldn't be a show unless this happened.
Unless Kev gave up.
It's just like a 3-year-old that gets distracted. Yeah. It
wouldn't be an episode of our show if Kev didn't give up at some point.
Oh, God. Wow. This is like a nuclear mall death.
This one should either be called the Crystal Mall Ooh. M-A-U-L death or the Cape Cod Mall M-A-U-L death.
No, I like Crystal better.
The Crystal Mall was kind of known because it had this like giant fucking chandelier like in the middle of the thing. And I think it just fell on your head.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Wow. I like that.
Or it shattered and bits of it came down and like just, you know, like the needler from fucking Halo just like fucking laced you up.
The fucking needler. I hated the needler.
The needler. The lamest of the Halo weapons.
Oh, God. I hate the needler.
Right? That thing was terrible, man.
That show's out. We should check that out. I heard it's terrible.
Wow. Dude, there's an entire freaking
you US still close the goddamn
portal
town.
Database here. I'm
save that tab for later, pal.
Yeah, I'm stopping right now. I'm going to close that up.
Bits and Silent Bobs.
Yeah.
What do you got? Come on.
You were Silent Bob there, bro.
I don't really have any others. I don't know. I wanted to talk about my favorite Ben Affleck line, but I already did that, so I can't do that.
Okay.
Yeah, to be fair, I've kind of sprinkled them out as we've been talking.
Yeah.
Talking about people.
Exactly. I think that's all I got. Somebody else go.
Silent Bob was not silent at the end of this movie.
I like that that was his only line.
Yeah. I like the running thread of Silent Bob, like, trying to use, like, Jedi powers through the whole thing. Like,
and then he succeeds, but he thinks he succeeds, but he didn't succeed.
He thinks he succeeds, but it's Willem fucking freaking out.
Yeah.
I do. Here's a bomb I'll add. I really, and it kind of dovetails off that, like, I really like what Kevin Smith has done in this one. I don't know if it's in any of the other ones, but, like, not specifically to Silent Bob, but there's a lot of like slapstick and kind of almost silent movie era humor and bits in this movie. And I don't know. I like that inclusion, you know, it just kind of made it a little bit different. You know, I like that a lot. And some of the silly kind of cartoony kind of stuff like him, you know, slipping on the sort of the wooden skate, you know what I mean? And then, you know, rolling across the floor and his head bashing through the wall. And, you know,
very
I don't know.
It's just
very much like that. I mean, not like I wasn't like laughing my ass off. I just appreciated it, I guess.
Twice crashing into the dressing room with Joey Lauren Adams.
Well, that was the setup for her doing her underwear trying in the middle of the store, too.
Right.
Which I thought was
exactly.
Funny. Yeah. She's like, fuck it. Whatever.
Yeah. No, there's some good layers there for sure.
The young girl sexcapade research thread was funny.
Yes.
May or may not have been in your version of the movie, but it was in my version of the movie.
No. That was in ours as well. Yeah. No, that was funny too, because that all paid off at the end with the whole who's your favorite new kid?
Oh my God, dude.
That was great.
Did she end up hooking up with a security guard in your version of the movie? Because I heard that was different.
No.
They bang in the Easter Bunny diorama in the mall in my version of the movie. And then that's why he's at the end at her book signing.
That's kind of weird.
Yeah, it's pretty weird.
Yeah, I liked her little calendar with, like, you know, like,
yeah,
her notes, like, you know, like the circle with an X through it means that I had an orgasm. The circle means that he had an orgasm. Like this, like, yeah.
The smiley face with lashes means that they went down on me.
Yeah.
Definitely.
What?
You know, it'd be kind of cool, man, is like a movie where
a website that has a list of malls.
What? No, I was gonna say this is 1,000%
good old fashioned mall porters.
1,000% off topic, but I just like it'd be cool if there was a movie about like the malls kind of coming to life and like transforming into these giant monsters and like destroying the freaking planet. Wouldn't it be great?
Wow, yeah. Man.
Yeah,
I think so, man. There's something there, dude.
There is nothing there, man.
There is something there. All right,
I was just
right
thinking
along.
About Nuggets. If like malls turned into giant robots and like we made a movie about it. That'd be cool.
Yeah, no, that is exactly what I was thinking. I was like, what if all these malls like came to life, turned into these like kind of giant robots, and they roamed around the U.S. just destroying everything with like laser beam eyes and all kinds of fire and shit.
All right. So this isn't exactly the same, but when I was a little kid, I used to fantasize that malls were like secret, like giant escape spacecraft that, like, you know, everybody would flock to, like in the
nice.
You know, the event of like a huge emergency or, you know, nuclear war or something like that. Like,
yeah, that I could get behind, Benny. A movie where the government emergency broadcast network finally turns on and it's like, everyone, please go to your nearest mall. And then they fly into space and people have to live as like if they were in a colony.
Yeah.
But you can only go around in the fucking hallways of the mall and go to the shops. And that's how you like sustain your ability. Yeah, I'm totally on board with that. I just picture the like Expanse style space stations that are just giant malls.
Yeah.
See, I'm on board.
Okay, I mean, I like that idea a lot, too. It'd be cool, too, if, like, all the malls, like, linked up in outer space and then just turned into, like, a giant kind of series station situation.
Yeah, be like Wall-E or something.
Right? Yeah, but more...
but more like a more,
no, Wall-E, but with more mall, yeah.
Yeah, Wall-E.
Molly.
Eva.
Oh my god, I don't know, right. There's such
we're
a
coming apart of the fucking seams here, boys.
And then I saw Dawn of the Dead, man. Where they like take refuge in the it's like a zombie movie where they take refuge in the mall.
Oh yeah,
Day of the Dead, dude. Great.
And then there's Choppping Mall, which is another great mall movie.
Chopping yes, Mall, is horror, that a horror movie?
A crappy horror movie, yes.
Oh yeah, so crappy.
I suppose I never realized just how much of a cultural phenomenon malls have been.
They really are,
like,
man.
That's serious. It's like when you've got a cheese-dicky horror movie made about an inanimate place to buy shit, like you, and a genre of music to Benny's mall soft conversations from episodes of yore.
Yes.
Yes. Mall soft.
I love mall soft.
I love same. Malsoft, and I love Kev finding out that Malsoft exists in, like, episode 3 of our show and being like, what? That's a thing? And being so pumped about it.
Yeah,
it really is.
Yeah. That was a great episode. I think... sorry, I'm still kind of stuck on this giant monster mall idea.
I discovered Malsoft when I was watching... I forget the name of the YouTuber... I think I subscribed to his channel, but there's a dude that just goes around to malls that are closed and kind of like breaks in and takes video footage of, you know,
urban exploring malls. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. And like all the music he puts in is like mall soft, like various vaporwave. Pretty cool.
That's totally a fucking the quintessential YouTube hole. I love it.
It was such a fucking YouTube hole. I was like, how did I get here?
You know you're an amazing hole when.
Why am I here?
Yeah.
Why am I 3 hours into a 5-hour video about malls?
Yeah.
Love it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Kev's writing the script to his screenplay about fucking mall robots. Maybe we can move on to a Nuggets test ratings.
Dude, this is a great idea, man. All right, let's do Nuggets.
Fucking
Cape
Codamus Prime.
There you go, dude. Finally, just embrace my idea because it's really good, dude. Cape Codamus Prime. It's so good, dude. Come on, man.
That's fucking great.
It takes weird shit like that I did to come up with great gold like that. Come on.
Oh,
God, Cape Codamus Prime. That is just gold, baby.
All right, Nuggets test ratings.
my God, dude. South Dakota only has two malls.
Wow. All
right, so...
We need to put, like, a fucking child protection on your computer so that you can't just, like, wander off into the internet.
Yeah, I think we need to give you another allotment of your special Valverdean fucking...
Ritalin?
ADHD drugs, yeah.
Yeah.
There you go. I don't have any nuggets.
No? You can't, we've kind of skirted one of the nuggets, which is that Joey Lauren Adams played T.S.'s identical twin brother's girlfriend in Dazed and Confused and plays ex-girlfriend to twin brother here.
That's true. That is a good one, too, man.
I just love that they're identical twin brothers. I just find that so fascinating how often that seems to come up.
Yeah, and how many of pairs of people like that are performers?
We did the security guard in T2. That was another one we were talking about.
Totally.
That's the only nugget I've got. Other than this gold nugget of a film idea you have for fucking Cape Codimus Prime.
Yeah, that is sick, dude. Cape Codimus Prime is the leader of the mall giant monsters.
We gotta get JCPenney involved somehow.
Definitely. Like, inside the head of the JCPenney mall robot is fucking...
Dude from Roadhouse. Yep.
Yes. Eating breakfast. All right, my only nugget is, was that I know, you know, the producers did not want, didn't think Jay should be Jay in the movie. Kevin Smith lobbied heavily for him, and they even made him have auditions, and Seth Green and Breckin Meyer were considered for the role of Jay.
What?
Yes, which I thought was pretty interesting.
Dude, we talked about that in...
Did we really?
In Airborn, how Seth Green was almost Jay.
No kidding.
Did we really?
Yeah, we did.
Wow, shit. Call that a death.
Ben doesn't remember us talking about it because he was 2 hours into a conversation about Airborne at that point. So he was just like, I'm fucking out of here, bro.
I was checking out malls on mallportals.com. So I'll be contributing to the... nugget proceedings.
Yes.
Today.
Yes.
Finally.
One is just, it's not even really, it's not a nugget, but as I was watching the movie, at one point, T.S. is talking to Brody, and he actually says something along the lines of, no, you're full of shit, but every once in a while you let a nugget slip out, and I thought of the nugget section of this show when he said that. So that's, I was like, oh boy, let one slip out. We're going to have to use that somewhere.
Love it.
The other one is while I was looking at the IMDb page while we were talking, I found out that there is indeed going to be a Twilight of the Mallrats movie coming.
Yeah, what? What's that about?
I have no idea. There's virtually no information on it, but it seems as though a bunch of the cast is going to be returning to reprise their roles. So,
Don't know how I feel about that.
I don't either.
We'll just have to see.
We will indeed, man. They're probably all working at the cookie store now.
Probably.
Yeah. That's not really a nugget either, but
no, that was good. I like it.
I think it belongs there.
The fact that they're gonna keep going with these things is
better than my terrible nugget. Rating? Are we ready for deaths?
Yeah, bro.
All right. This week we've got the forgetting Sven Ole Thorsen death. That was mine. Chad had a who is Sven Ole Thorsen death. Ben had a late recording start death. Ben had a Star Wars death. Chad had a Matrix death. Ben had a nice Batman death, which is somehow different from the Batman death. I had the Bob Ross eject on the wallet death. Ben and I both accrued a combined Armatron Home of the Big King death. Personal favorite. Chad and I had a Calvin Klein death. And let's see. You had the Three's Company, Priscilla Barnes death, Chad. Then I had the Crystal Mall death and the chandelier fail in my head. And then I had the Seth Green as Jay death.
It's a lot of deaths, bro.
Yeah, it was good. It was definitely a healthy a healthy lineup of deaths this week. Everybody represented heavily, especially Benny. I'd like to give a shout out to Benny for representing in the death section really nicely. And yeah, that's it.
Nice ratings. Done, Benny.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, well done, bud. Appreciate your effort and enthusiasm. We appreciate you. All right, ratings. What are we rating this cult icon?
I don't know, bro. Part of me like is hesitant to rate it now that I realize I watched a different cut.
But rate the version you watched.
Fucking there you piece go. Of shit. Wow. That's why I'm hesitant. Like, really was just like, this sucked. There were like moments, you know, for sure. And maybe it was like the nostalgic moments where it was, you know, remembering the jokes that I used to find really funny and seeing him again and stuff. But it was, yeah, it was pretty shit. So that's why I'm hesitant. Like, I think it's like Idiocracy territory, which is like a 3.1. So, yeah, like a low 3. Call it a 3.2.
Wow, that's not as bad as I thought you were going to. I thought you were going to go way lower.
Well, I think I'm trying to be a bit forgiving just because.
Indeed. Yeah.
I think it's not accurate, you know? And definitely hearing sure. you guys talk about it makes me feel a little bit more nostalgic to it. I also am willing to incorporate the idea that, like, this very much was like early pre-nerds are actually pre-nerdy topics are actually cool kind of stuff. And like, I have a lot of sympathy for that as well.
Sure.
Indeed.
Benny, you want to go next or last? Yeah, go for it.
I'll go. Whatever. So yeah, this isn't a masterpiece by any stretch of the imagination, but it's got some solid jokes, man. It's got some good laughs in there. It's not like, Jesus, let me try and rephrase my thoughts here.
Take your time. Start over if need be.
You know when you have like 10 things to say and they all try to come out at the same time?
Yes, mm-hmm. I do. Often.
Mm-hmm. 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 I don't know if this has nostalgic value as much as it's like, I don't know, it just kind of, at the time I watched it, sort of fit like a puzzle piece into, you know, my life. It just like it resonated with me. So, Jesus Christ, I'm really dropping the ball here. I guess I'll just give it the rating.
No, with that post-production, being said, bro.
I'm gonna do whatever. We also, want. Like, I feel like comedy movies, like, you can be a little more forgiving with them. You know, like, it's not like we're talking,
yeah,
some like drama masterpiece here, or you know, a visual masterpiece of like science fiction or something. Like, it's indeed. It's just a simple comedy movie, you know. So I'm going to go with an 8 on this, you know?
Nice.
Does it stand up to like some, I don't know, as like Blade Runner or something, you know? No, of course not. But for a comedy movie and for what it is, I'm giving it an 8. I like it.
I like it too.
Wow. Yeah. I really like that rating. I'll echo that actually. I'll echo
you liked that?
No, yeah, I liked your reasoning and your rating.
That was a train wreck.
No, but I liked your reasoning. It was good. I think I'll echo that. I'm going to go with a 7.73. Yeah, I'm trying to switch it up.
Is that an homage to like the mall fucking data set that you were looking at a minute ago?
Yeah, there's a hidden code in my rating.
That's actually the 773 Queens Boulevard is the location exactly. of the Crystal Mall.
Yep.
You get a free pretzel you get a free Orange Julius at the food court.
Exactly. It's a secret coordinates to guide you to a secret prize. Yeah, 7.73. Again, not a masterpiece, not a dramatic masterpiece like Ben said, but it's definitely a classic. It's definitely a cult movie. Even though it's like kind of like a little raw and janky because it's like Smith's second movie, it's still great and it still holds up. You know, no denying that. And but it's just I still found so many things funny in this movie. You know, it was good. I wish I had gotten to do a second go over with it. But yeah, it was certainly enjoyable to watch. So yeah, thumbs up, 7.73.
Two thumbs up. Points, dude. 2.652 thumbs up.
All right, all right. I'll go, Chad. What are we doing next?
Chad,
week?
You should just change your rating to pi.
There you should.
Perfect. 3.14.
I will.
3.147.73.
Love it. We're doing the new Baffman next week.
Dude, new Baffman. Love it. Can't wait. Let's get into it.
I'm going to deep fake Ben Affleck's face onto Pattinson's face before I watch it.
Do it, man. I love that idea. Well, there you have it, folks. Baffman next week. Stay tuned for that and set aside some time to watch it because it's a long one. Thanks for joining us for Mallrats, and we will see you on another time.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
And that is going to wrap up this week's episode. Folks, as always, if you'd like to support the show, you can do so in a number of great ways. Tell a friend. You can throw us a few cents or a dollar on
Venmo.
Thank you. No. Patreon. That's right. Patreon.com/EBD podcast. You can also rate us and review us wherever you get your podcasts. And tell your friends, of course. It's the best way to do so. If you can find the show notes for this episode in your podcast app, choice, or at our website, ebd.fm/episodes/155. Don't forget to follow us on social. We're everywhere using the handle at EBD Podcast, and we definitely spend most of our time on Instagram chatting with you folks at home. And that's it. Thanks for joining us for Mallrats. We'll see you next week for the new Baffman. Laters.
Beady. Stop into it. Cape Cod Mall.
And the old clock on the wall tells me it's about time to call it a day. This painting's about finished, so I hope you really enjoyed it. I look forward to seeing you again next time. And from all of us here, happy painting. God bless.
God, bro. Jesus Christ.
Oh, God.
Cape Cod Mall.